He's a legend here in Tampa Bay and now enshrined among the Buccaneer immortals in the Ring of Honor. He's a man that is responsible for two Super Bowl championships. He's also a man that is measured by far more than his football accomplishments. Tonight, we introduce you one-on-one to Tony Dungy. Faith, family, and football. Chronicle is next. Hello and welcome to Chronicle. I'm JP Peterson. Now behind me is the Buccaneers Ring of Honor where Tony Dungy was enshrined a few weeks ago. And there's so many dimensions to this man and he can only be measured by the thousands of lives that he's impacted here in Tampa Bay. I had a chance to sit down with him in September for a very revealing interview, some stories you probably have not heard. But first, let's take a look at some of his accolades.
Here are some of Tony Dungy's milestones. January 22nd, 1996, named head coach of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. January 22nd, 2002, named head coach, Indianapolis Colts. February 4, 2007, won the Super Bowl against the Chicago Bears. July 10, 2007, number one New York Times bestseller, Quiet Strength. August 6, 2016, enshrined into the NFL Hall of Fame. And September 24, 2018, enshrined into the Buccaneers Ring of Honor. And it was a special night at Raymond James Stadium. Surrounded by almost 100 of his former players and coaches, Tony Dungy stood at midfield and showed the same class and elegance that has made him a legend in Tampa Bay. Let's relive that special night. Under a full moon, it was a magical evening at Ray J. The surprise undefeated Buccaneers taking on the equally surprising winless Pittsburgh Steelers. Prime time. The place was electric under the hot lights of Monday Night Football and honoring a Tampa Bay legend, Tony Dungy. During our countdown to kickoff pregame show on MOR-TV, another Buccaneer legend, Rondé Barber, told me what Tony meant to him.
Yeah, well, more as a man than as a football player. He taught me how to be a pro, obviously, but I'm constantly humbled when I'm around him, even today. I mean, 20 years ago, I remember being in my first meeting with him and saying, I'm the luckiest guy in the world to be in this locker room with the team that we had, with that guy leading us. And unfortunately, we didn't win a Super Bowl with him, but he put us on the right path.
On the field, the Bucs got off to a slow start, and the Steelers came after Fitzmagic. But that did not damper the enthusiasm on the sidelines as Buccaneer royalty were all there to honor their coach and mentor. Derek Brooks and Warren Sapp sporting their gold NFL Hall of Fame jackets. Mike Allstott having some fun with sideline photographers looking for the great action shot. I talked to Mike about Tony's impact with him.
You know, I was talking to Tony earlier and I said, hey, this is well deserved. You started all this. Even what's going on today, you started all this and you built it and we're just continuing it, even in the community, with all of us in the community doing what we do. He was the ringleader there. And now he's getting obviously honored in Tampa and this is a great day for him.
The current Bucs headed to the locker room at halftime, yielding to Bucs history as dozens of Tony's former players and coaches took over center stage to honor the man that gave them so much and gave so much to this community. After the ceremony, I was able to catch up with some of the men whose lives were changed by their former coach.
He meant everything. I mean, you just listen to his words and things he say, things he preached about Christianity and all of that. I mean, it was awesome. I mean, to be a part of his first draft class in 96, I know for me personally and probably for a lot of other players, it was probably no better blessing than to be drafted, you know, by him.
What did Tony Dungy mean to you in your career?
Right, he meant a lot. He challenged me. He helped me grow up, become a man, and you know, just how he's impacted my life over the years. I mean, he's a father figure in a sense. So I love him, I respect him, and I like what he stands for. He's a Christian. He led us in the right way. So it's a guy that I will always cherish.
And afterwards, Tony again thanked his former players for making it such a special evening.
This one in your hometown, and with all the work that went into building this, this one is really special because it's Tampa and it's where I live and where our family lives.
Now that is a full resume and a life full lived. All right, when we come back, we'll take a look at the impact that Tony has had on our community here in Tampa Bay. Stay with us.
You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR. You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR.
I told them to dream and think about their future, to visualize getting that high school diploma. But think about it and visualize when you got that diploma, you're not only getting that piece of paper, but someone was giving you a
Tony check. Dungy talking to a packed house of students at Gibbs High School in St. Petersburg.
So I really appreciate being here today. I appreciate what our teachers here at Gibbs are doing, the administrators. Appreciate the students and the efforts you're making to make your school the best it can be.
It was Dad's Take Your Child to School Day, part of the Day of Dialogue Conference, designed to inspire African-American males to take school seriously.
And welcome back to Chronicles. I'm JP Peterson. You know, so many great memories for Tony here in Raymond James Stadium, including actual Buccaneer playoff wins. Yes, it happened right here. But he's done so much more to impact this community in other ways through his work with All Pro Dads, his church, and other social programs. I asked him, why Tampa Bay?
Why have you chosen Tampa Bay?
Tampa's been special for us, and my wife Lauren and I and our kids have grown up here. They feel like this is their hometown. The people have made us feel like it's my hometown. And I came here in 96 again feeling like, gosh, the Lord has brought us here for something special. And I thought it was football, and it didn't really turn out to be that way. It was those relationships that you build and just the fiber of being here and trying to make the Tampa area a better place to live.
And your book, you're an author too. Never saw that coming. Quiet Strength, your first book, was the number one bestseller on the New York Times list. I love the title, Principles, Practices, Priorities of a Winning Life. And you've said writing that book and your experiences from that are more satisfying than winning the Super Bowl. How come?
I've gotten letters from high school teachers saying, I'm trying to get boys to read. They won't read anything, but I've got a whole classroom full of boys reading this. I've had coaches tell me, hey, I gave this to a certain player and it really changed the way he did things. Mm-hmm. So you get people who read not necessarily about your life, but about your thoughts and your principles and driving force, you know, with God in my life. And to get people to understand that and to benefit from that, that's been gratifying.
And you've also co-authored books with your wife, Lauren. What has she meant to you in your life?
Well, I think our journey has been really special. And we've been in this whole thing together for 35 years now. And it's been a wonderful journey. One of the things that was important to me, I took my wife on all our road trips in Tampa and in Indianapolis because I thought our players needed to see that husband and wife being together. And so many of these young men don't get to see that growing up. And just for me to have that partner in life, to go through the ups and downs for 35 years, couldn't do it without her.
When we come back, we'll take a look at Tony's impact in the NFL, including one of his pupils, who won a Super Bowl. Stay with us.
You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR. You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR.
Coach just provided a daily blueprint with how he approached it. He was just himself every day. It was a steady focus and compass through unsteady waters that can be an NFL season. I felt that working for him is steady leadership. Guys knew where they stood front with him. He was a clean communicator, and I think that those are some of the key ingredients that allowed him to be successful. Successful in multiple places, successful for an extended period of time.
To say that Tony Dungy has had an enormous impact on the African-American coaches in the NFL would be a tremendous understatement. He has opened so many doors. In fact, now there are 7 African-American head coaches in the NFL, something Tony is very proud of.
And you've had incredible social impact as well in the NFL community, the first African-American coach to win the Super Bowl. What that accomplishment, what does that mean to you in having opened doors for so many?
JP, I came into the National Football League. There were 10 African-American assistant coaches in the entire NFL. And you would go sometimes 3-4 weeks on your sideline, the other sideline, not see an African-American coach. And so to go from that to seeing guys get opportunities and realizing that there could have been 100 coaches, African-American coaches, who could have won a Super Bowl but didn't get the opportunity. And God put me there to be the one to represent them. That was special. But then I also had an opportunity to say, you know what, those doors maybe that didn't get open before, I can open some of those. And to hire Mike Tomlin and Lovie Smith and Herm Edwards and Leslie Frazier and to see them go on and have tremendous success, that's been very, very proud moments for me.
You mentioned Mike Tomlin. What did you see in him that you when you hired him? And did you see him becoming such a great Super Bowl winning coach himself?
You could see it with Mike right away. One of the things that I always did when we had an opening on the staff, I would always talk to our college scouts. Mm-hmm. You know, who's out there? Who's a young coach that is a great teacher, that's a great communicator, somebody that I wouldn't know? And that's how I ended up finding Rod Marinelli and Lovie Smith and Joe Barry and Mike Tomlin. But they came back and said, hey, there's a young coach at the University of Cincinnati. He's great, turns out tremendous players. I interviewed Mike, and in 5 minutes, you could see the confidence that wasn't cocky, but it was a confidence that I know what I'm doing, the ability to communicate. And then he steps in the room, and he's got Rondé Barber and John Lynch, who are perennial Pro Bowlers. And then he's got young guys who he's got to bring on. And he connected with all of them right away. So it didn't take long to see he was going to be special.
So when you look for coaches, you look more for the communicators and more of those characteristics than maybe X's and O's.
Yes, you look for teachers.
Yeah.
And we had a system in place. We knew what we wanted to do offensively and defensively. And most good coaches can adapt to systems, and they know football. But who can get that across to players? Who can turn the light bulb on for their individual players? And that's where the Rod Marinellis and Mike Tomlins and Mike Shula's, guys like that, were very special.
And you might have learned some of that from Chuck Knoll, I'm guessing.
I did.
Coach, he made you the first African-American coordinator in football. What did that mean to you? What did his impact mean to you?
Coach Knoll had a huge impact on me, just teaching me what's important about life and what's important about football and teaching and coaching. A couple of things I learned from him right away. The first meeting I was ever in with him as a 21-year-old rookie, he said, welcome to the National Football League. Getting paid to play football makes it your profession, but don't make it your life. If you make football your life, you're going to be disappointed when you leave the game. And then 6 years later, I'm on his coaching staff, and he told me, hey, your job is to help your players play better. That's the only job you have, whether you're an assistant, coordinator, head coach, you're there to help your players. And so many coaches don't think of it that way. They think, I'm in charge, I'm here to have a great game plan, I'm here to be the disciplinarian. He said, no, you're here to help. So working for him, getting those lessons, and then when I was 28 years old, he had a chance to hire anybody in the world to be his defensive coordinator, and he said, no, you know more about this system than anyone, you're my guy. That did so much for me personally and for my career.
When we come back, we'll see how Coach Dungy is impacting today's Buccaneer players and their work in the community. Stay with us.
You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR. You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR. Here's your host, JP Peterson.
Commitment to the community. That was Tony's first message to his football team when he was hired here in 1996. The players found it a bit odd, but eventually they figured it out. That's how they were going to win football games.
When you talk about changing a culture, Tony, I mean, when you came here in 96, this was not only the team, but the town. It was called Loserville, and you built that Super Bowl champion. How did you go about building that culture change? You can't change all the players at once. How do you do it?
I remember coming in 1996 and having every veteran player come into my office. Tell me, in your opinion, what's gone wrong? What do we need to change to win? Got a lot of different answers, but it really came down to we've got to believe we can win. And so it was instilling that we're going to practice like champions, we're going to do everything the right way, whether it's on the field or off the field. We're going to do things the right way, and that's going to do it. And a lot of players didn't buy into that right away. What is how we go to the lunchroom? What is what we do on Tuesdays? How does that impact the game on Sunday? But as they started to understand and get it, that hey, you live like a champion, you act like a champion, you work like a champion all the time, and the players bought into it.
And I guess this kind of dovetails with that. How does your Christian faith help you win games? I mean, a lot of people are skeptical of that. God doesn't take sides, but I think it's very interesting how when you instill those characteristics and you are an example of that, connect the dots for us. How does that help you win?
Well, I came and my Christian faith was a big part of it. And so I felt like we were here to do more than just win football games. And I tried to get that across to the players that we're going to win for sure. That's what we're called to do. But we've got to impact the community. We've got to make Tampa a better place to live. And more than anything, we've got to be role models and examples for the young people that are watching us. And I remember my first talk with the team, I probably talked 95% of the time about that. And Derek Brooks came to me later and said, you know, hey, I lost more games in 1 year here than I've lost in my whole life. You didn't say anything about winning football games. And I said, Derek, I did. Everything I was talking about is about winning. And again, once the players understood that and bought into it, I think we took off.
When we come back, we'll hear from the godfather of the locker room, Derek Brooks, double nickel, and how Tony's message to him inspired their Super Bowl championship.
You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR. You're watching Chronicle, Tony Dungy on MOR.
Welcome back to Chronicle. I'm JP Peterson. You know, probably no player was closer to Tony Dungy than Derek Brooks, fellow Hall of Famer. And in a revealing interview that we will feature next month in MOR Chronicles, Derek told me a story you probably never heard before about the night Tony was fired and how that led to the Bucs Super Bowl win.
I think for me, how Coach impacted me that year was when they fired him that March. And you know, I was an emotional wreck. You know, wasn't no poison in the noise for me, for sure. And, you know, him having the opportunity to meet with me in the office that they just fired him in the rain. You know, I go there to see him. He pulls me to the side in the office. He said, Derek, you need to move on. And he informs me of the opportunity that he's going to have come shortly with the Colts. And in order for our team to be successful, I need to move on. I need to channel all these emotions now, get rid of them, and lead this football team. And he said, the team is on the brink, have some championship pedigree, and hopefully these changes and you guys getting better at what you're doing, think you can get there. He said, but if you don't move on and lead this team's gonna self-destruct. You cannot, and he frankly told me, you cannot lose it at this point. Channel all these emotions, get yourself together and lead this team.
And
that's what's so amazing about it, in this moment of, you know, disappointment for me and obviously for him, that he has the mindset to still think about this team and me as a man and what I need to do versus agreeing with me, and we both punch a hole in the wall.
Exactly.
You did.
Which 99% of everybody would do.
Exactly.
Wallow in the pity.
But it's that same demeanor that when I see him eulogize his son.
I was just thinking about that same moment.
That's what I saw, that man, that temperament. And again, I can only say that's the God that's in him that we all get a chance to touch, see, and feel.
Yeah, he seemed more worried in that moment when he was eulogizing his son about us.
Yes.
And how we were handling it and how his team was handling it.
Mm-hmm.
That was one of the most powerful moments of my life, watching that.
Absolutely. And to really then see how openly grateful he was to the Glazers for giving him an opportunity to be a head coach and this platform they gave him to now expand outward to change the world.
And you can see much more of my interview with Derek on the next edition of Chronicle. That's Tuesday, November 20th at 8 p.m.
Well, that's our show. We hope you've enjoyed Tony Dungy, Faith, Family, and Football. And I'd personally like to thank Tony for sitting down with us and the impact that he's had on my life. Next month, Derek Brooks in a very revealing interview. Until then, I'm JP Peterson. We'll see you next time.